सम प्रभ निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा। आई एम स्टार्टिंग द थ्री डे talk on Rahu. Will give me my beetle net and that from there. Just a minute, I'll come. Wait a minute. Gopalam Uravanamalam Nayana Vishalam Dukkaharam Vrindavana Chandram Ananda Kandam Paramanandam धरणिधरम भजनंद कुमारम सर्वसुखसारम तत् विचारम ब्रह्मपरम भजनंद कुमारम सर्वसुखसारम तत्व विचारम दुखहरम। यू स्टार्ट नाउ। आई विल स्टार्ट दिस थ्री डे सीरीज by giving you a background of the importance of Rahu, and I'll be making use of Rahu from both of these books. One is written by me, Astrology and Karma, which has 50 or more than 50 illustrations along with some divisional horoscopes, so that will make it nearly 70. And here you have 100 illustrations, 77 horoscopes and 23 divisional horoscopes. Now this is the best book ever written on Rahu, and it is one of the best books on Vedic astrology written in this century, let me tell you this. When you see how well planned it is, and it is by Shivaraj Sharma, whom I guided, very beautifully planned book. You will see that, how beautifully, no book you will see written by any author has been so well planned systematically. This book. So, I am going to cover part of that book and part of my book, because in both I have dealt with Rahu. Before knowing the story of Rahu, certain background about Rahu you must have. What is the background? Background is, you must have heard of Samudra Manthan, or what is known as the churning of the ocean. When it was decided to churn the ocean, from out of the ocean came out Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth. Symbolically it means there is so much wealth in the sea. Then came out poison and nectar both. When the poison became very deadly and started killing all the people in the world, Lord Shiva, whose stotra we have done together, to save humanity and all the living creatures, drank it off, and with his yogic power allowed this to stay in his neck and not go down. So the whole neck became blue. So in Sanskrit the word blue is neela. So therefore one of the synonyms for Lord Shiva is Neelakantha. Neelakantha means he who has blue neck. So Lord Shiva drank it. While drinking, some little bits dropped here and there. Those little bits were swallowed by all those poisonous insects and reptiles in the world which keep troubling us. So therefore, a little bit of that poison which was licked was also licked by snakes. This story you must remember, snakes, right? Okay. When the nectar came out, Lord Vishnu decided very rightly that the nectar should be given only to gods, devata, the divine persons, and not the devils. Because once you drink nectar, you become immortal. If devils were to become immortal, the world would be a terrible place. So devils must die and gods must have immortality. So he secretly called gods and started serving them. One of the devils came in the disguise of God when he came to know, and he started partaking of the nectar. The sun and the moon noticed it. They recognized that it was a devil, a rakshasa, a monster, and complained to Lord Vishnu. Lord Vishnu took his Sudarshan Chakra, or a wheel with which he used to chop off anyone's head, and threw it. By the time the wheel reached this monster and chopped him off, the nectar had already gone down inside him. So he had to become immortal. But his body was cut into two parts. The upper part became Rahu and the lower part became Ketu. That is the legend you have to remember all the time. So it is the nectar which has gone into the body. He is a monster by nature. Right? One. The second point you have to remember is, there is always big debate in the world, in which country did astrology originate? Right? Someone will say Egypt, someone will say Babylonia, someone will say India, someone will say Greece. There is no question of astrology originating in any culture other than India. A country which does not believe in transmigration of souls, rebirths, cannot have astrology. The horoscope you are born with is an allotment of the karmas of past life. That is known as prarabdha, number one. Number two, last year in the month of July, in the last trip in the month of July, I was invited by Robert Hand and Robert Smits to attend their seminar on Project Hindsight. There, when Robert Hand and Robert Smits were presenting, a dasha of 72 years, they discovered some dasha. You may have heard about it, right? Dasha of Egypt. They presented a dasha of 72 years with each planet having 9 years. Then Robert Smits said Sun, Moon, Mars, Mercury, Jupiter, Venus, Saturn. He 9 × 7 will be how much? 63. The dasha is of 72 years. Then he came out with, then immediately, because it is a participative one, I said, how do you get only 7 planets here? 7 × 9 is 63. It is a 72-year cycle, but you are getting 63 years. What about the missing 9? So Mr. Robert Smith said, perhaps there was a mistake he had committed. I said, no, you have not committed a mistake. They asked me to tell what was that missing part. I said, I will tell you tomorrow when you present the whole thing full length. Next day when they presented, when Robert Hand was presenting, I said, how did Egyptians calculate eclipses? They were not able to find out the correct answer. I said, you cannot calculate eclipses unless you have Rahu and Ketu. Now the Hindu story of the churning of the ocean and Lord Vishnu chopping off the head of the monster into two parts, Rahu and Ketu, will definitely tell you that Rahu and Ketu became enemies of sun and moon from that day. At the time of eclipse, they swallow the sun and the moon. They take revenge every year. Right? Rahu and Ketu. Now I said the 8th 9 year part is Rahu's. So 8 into 9 will give you 72. And there is in Parashara Hora Shastra a dasha known as Dvisaptati Samadasha or 72 years. So what you are presenting is nothing new to me. I have used it for my predictions. So I helped them. Then next day I had to give a long lecture to them on explaining how dasha systems were made use of in India. Explaining the Jaimini dashas and this. I have written book on Jaimini Char Dasha and I had again brought Manduk Dasha, Jaiminis. In the astrology of our country, if you use only one dasha, you will commit a mistake. There must be a cross check. In Delhi, in the course we have, we teach other dashas. I teach particularly Jaimini dashas also. Here in USA, they wanted to know how I was predicting through Jaimini's Chardasha. No one had done any research on how to make use of Jaimini's Chardasha to predict. It took me 30 years to find out the method, and I produced a book, Predicting Through Jaimini's Chardasha. I think I had brought it last time. Mm-hmm. And you have read that. And of course, she knows it. After I went back from my last tour, they called me to Rajasthan and presented me a gold medal, saying that for 2000 years, Jaimini's Chardasha was never explored by anyone for predictions, and I had done it. They tested it rigorously on thousands of horoscopes, about 40 of them. Then I brought Manduk Dasha again. Now the importance I'm telling you is, in Jaimini also Rahu is made use of. And Ketu is made use of. In Jaimini, Rahu has been given dual ownership of Aquarius along with Saturn. And Ketu has been given dual ownership along of Scorpio along with Mars. So therefore, you must understand, Rahu behaves like Saturn, Ketu behaves like Mars. That is a common belief. If you limit yourself to that, then you will not know how to make use of Rahu. It is okay to say Shanivat Rahu, Kujavat Ketu. That's all right. But then don't limit yourself to that. As most of the astrologers coming from India are writing in the journals will say, no. Rahu has its own independent role. Ketu has its own independent role. Now what I did was, I have been after this, but since I got involved in Jaimini astrology, I gave the subject to one of a very bright researchers, Shivaraj Sharma, and asked him to produce the book. This book should have come out about 1 year ago or even more. This time after I went back, I asked him to give me his manuscript, sat down with him, edited, revised, and the scheme of presentation here is better than the best book you will have ever read in East or West. Let me tell you this.
There's a book by Manik Chand Jain.
No, that doesn't give anything. You will see this. I know that.
I thought it was pretty good.
It doesn't show you how to make use of astrology for Rahu for predictions in the dasha system, and you will see this book. I'll show you. Manak Chand's books I have seen. I know that. Now, I had referred to Rahu and Ketu in my Astrology, Destiny and Wheel of Time. And I had also referred to 12 points which are meant for astrologers in my book, Yogi's Destiny and Wheel of Time. I am first reading it out.
We don't have extra of this. Those that don't have it will get it tomorrow.
I'm reading out Rahu and Ketu. This is from my book. In Parashari astrology, Rahu and Ketu have not been allotted ownership of any house. In interpreting the effects of these, the standardized principles are used generally. A. See where Rahu and Ketu are posited. if they are in Kendras, which means 1, 4, 7, 10 from the ascendant, they behave as Kendra lords. And if they are posited in Trikonas, trines, they behave like Trikona lords. The planets which aspect Rahu and Ketu modify their nature according to their own nature, ownership, etc. See, planets which are conjunct with Rahu and Ketu modify their results according to their own nature and ownership, etc. Some exceptions. In interpreting the results of Rahu and Ketu, some exceptions have been made in some books. A. The aspect of Jupiter on Rahu and Ketu lent to them a strong protective cover to give good results. I have found it generally working very well. B. In the case of Rahu and Ketu, especially as in the case of other planets, the theory of dispositors is applied. For example, if Rahu is in Aries, see where its Lord Mars is from the Lagna. C. Rahu and Ketu form an axis in every horoscope. Each axis has a significance of its own. It is both a matter of controversy, dispute and bewilderment among astrologers. Deep researches have to be done as Rahu and Ketu hide in their bosom many mysteries of a very deep nature. Therefore, this book is known as The Mystery of Rahu in your horoscope, right? Then, from the Yogi's Destiny Wheel of Time, summing up, astrologers are ordinary human beings. The good ones among them are well-read and quite successful in the art of prediction, but they cannot see the ultimate like yogis infallibly. 2. There are many good astrologers in India who predict well but cannot discuss the subject with the disciplined mind of academicians. I have met hundreds and I respect them. I give them credit for part successes only. They work in narrow orbits with reasonable success. 3. Those I have listed here were all-rounders. I have gone running to astrologers when I heard about their reputation and have seen their predictions and analyzed the horoscopes they had read. Even if those predictions were successful, they were so clear that anyone could have given such predictions. Many of the successful predictions I have given could have been given by others also. Yet there is no great astrologer anywhere in the world. World's best astrologers are Indians, are those non-Indians who do Vedic astrology. Yogis do not give predictions, but they help their disciples. Astrologers will therefore have some useful role in the society always. Those who depend too much on astrological predictions are the mentally sick persons or timid human beings. Those who do not seek guidance from astrologers may sometime or the other misplan their lives. Astrology is a human necessity, yet it can make you fatalistically stupid. Astrology is that spark divine which illumines your path, but with the ever-present danger of blurring your vision of life. Remember that background. And the planet that blurs your vision of life most is Rahu. I start with this. Okay? As an example, I'll start with my own horoscope. In the year 1981, I was entering the period of Saturn Rahu. Right? Now in my horoscope you see Rahu is in the 6th house. Right? Are you able to follow this? Okay, you draw the northern one. Libra ascendant, Venus, Moon, Mars in Libra. Okay? Saturn in Sagittarius, 3rd house. Rahu in Pisces, 6th house. Okay? Jupiter in Cancer, the 10th house. Sun, Mercury and Ketu in the 12th house, that is in Virgo. Saturn, Rahu periods are generally dreaded by people. Right? My own friends are feared. They are afraid of it, generally. My own friend saw my horoscope and told me that I was going to enter a most terrible period of my life. I told them I was entering a period of international fame. My international fame came from the fact that in the Delhi Municipal Corporation, which was always in financial difficulties, I produced 4 surplus budgets successively by enforcing financial discipline. First time Delhi Municipal Corporation had surplus budget without raising taxes, without getting any grant from the government. When your Washington DC's civic body collapsed, they had to go to the federal government to take grants to save it. It was till then quoted as the best example in the world, Washington DC example. After my surplus budgets, my case is being quoted all over the world as the best example of controls of financial controls of civic bodies. I was invited to Germany to speak on financial controls of civic bodies. But I said I would not go because it was a bad period for my mother. And my mother died in 1984. And I also became internationally famous as an astrologer when in 1982, 6th January, New York Herald Tribune covered an astrology conference in Delhi and wrote about me 2 full paragraphs. They never covered an Indian astrologer to such an extent as they did, January 6, 1982. New York Herald Tribune. Now, why did this happen in Saturn, Rahu? It is here that we have what is known as Yogaja, that is the yoga producing combinations of Vedic astrology, 80% of which is not available in the books. The books you read are generally poor, bad, wooden translations, and they give you only 20% of the astrological knowledge of India, nothing more than this. 80% is still hidden in parampara or tradition. So when we go to those old astrologers in the village, not in the cities. In the cities you have people who publicize themselves very well and they are frauds, most of them. They will frighten you, charge you money, talk about Kal Sarp Yoga and ask you to do Shanti. But in the villages we have very fine astrologers who cannot communicate well except in their own languages. If you bring them on the stage, they cannot even speak well. But if you went to them and talked to them, you will find something very illuminating emerging out. They have not been able to move out of their mental grooves. So they cannot modernize astrology. But whatever traditional knowledge they have is very sound. Then many of them have their family secrets with them. From them I saw how they made use of Rahu Ketu, and Shivraj Sharma took some of these things. I will show you how Rahu, not Ketu here, could be made use of effectively, then you may read the book later. Now in my horoscope you please notice Rahu is being aspected by Jupiter and also Mercury, 2 exalted planets. Right? Right? And Rahu is in Kendra from Saturn, in the 4th house from Saturn. The mutual position of the Mahadasha Lord Saturn and the Antardasha Lord Rahu is Kendra. Right? 1, 4. And this is being aspected by Jupiter and by Mercury, two exalted planets. More important, Rahu is in the 6th house from the Lagna and the Moon. When Rahu is in the 6th house from either Lagna or the Moon and is aspected by Jupiter, it is known as Mahalakshmi Yoga. Rahu. You have Ketu being aspected. Have you Ketu being aspected by?
Rahu is a mighty 12.
We'll come to that. So, that is known as Astalakshmi Yoga. Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth. It is not I who got any wealth. My salary was what it was. But the results of Astalakshmi Yoga was, I produced 4 surplus budgets in a corporation which was financially collapsing. Right? And I got such a big name and fame. So Astalakshmi Yoga must have its effect somewhere or the other. I am starting on an optimistic note before I come to the dangerous examples. Okay? So you please. Pardon?
You say that.
Yes, correct, correct.
If it's conjoined.
Oh yes, it joins Jupiter also, but then there is a difference. When it joins Jupiter, it can become bad also, Guru Chandali Yoga. When Jupiter is aspecting Rahu, it is not Guru Chandali Yoga. That difference is there. Okay. Now, every combination has a negative and positive sign. So, I'll first tell you 3 things. I am calling it the theory of triple threes. Right? Remember this all your life. Shall I draw the chart and show you? Draw this. You got it? That's okay. I'll do it now. Now, I'll start by telling you what I call the theory of triple three for your understanding. You see, you get many translations in English. You may note them down also as I am talking. Okay, shall I start? The translations you get in English are in our own languages in our country, 80% of them are totally stupid translations. Because they give you only literal translation. The Sanskrit tradition is to give 3 meanings at 3 levels. One is known as Shabdartha. Shabdartha means the literal meaning. In the Arsh Vidya Gurukulam, before coming here, I was teaching the Manduk Dasha of Gemini. Penny attended that. In the first half, I showed the use of Karakansha and also showed how meaningless many translations were in English on Gemini Sutras. For example, if you say Karakansha is a Mesha, you say fear of rat and cat. What is the meaning? You say, what is the meaning of rat and cat? At least in America and in your houses, I neither see rat nor see cat. In India, I can understand. But rat and cat, and what is the fear? That is the literal meaning, they will just give it there. So, after seeing literal meaning, now you have to go to the Lakshyartha. Lakshyartha means the implied meaning.
No.
Shabdartha, Bhavartha, Bhavartha. Sorry, I'll come to Bhavartha. Implied meaning. When you say rat and cat, what you mean is, you get into sometime or the other into some sort of a relationship in which there is enmity which you create. The enmity of rat with the cat. Right? A hint is given for you to understand. So if you just translate rat and cat, fear of rat and cat, then you are doomed. You just don't understand. The tendency of a person having his Karakansha in Aries is the tendency of a strong personality who by executing certain decisions is bound to provoke opposition against himself. That is the meaning. Bound to provoke opposition against him. I am just giving an example. Then we come to Lakshyartha, the secret meaning. The secret meaning is such a personality will rise high, very high in life. It is only have-nots that attack the haves, right? And it goes on like that. I give one simple example. In Jaimini Sutras, when a combination is given, sutra means a bundle, a thread rounded up. So you have to unravel the whole thing, sutra. People ask me, what is sutra? I tell them, sutra means this. Just watch me here. This is a sutra. Now, you don't know where it begins and where it ends. Right? It is a coil. Now, you have to keep on unraveling. One sutra of Jaimini says, if such and such combination exists, this man will overcome obstacles in his spiritual life. That's all it says. Now, apply your intelligence and find out what does it mean. If such and such combination exists, this man will overcome obstacles to spiritual life. Now, three parts now. Which means, one, he will have a spiritual life.
Two, he will have obstacles.
Two, he will have obstacles.
Three,
he will overcome. Okay? He will have a spiritual life, first combination. He will have obstacles coming, second combination. Now work out, obstacles are coming from where, from which source? Woman, money, government, brother, sister, mother, from whom?
I think the obstacles will come from within himself, his own tendencies towards materialism.
Correct. So obstacles will come and he will overcome. Now you have to time when will his spiritual life start, how and when the obstacles will come and how will overcome. That is how the Lakshyartha, the third part, comes into play. When I started writing a commentary on that particular sutra, I reached 20 pages and I stopped. I said I will never be able to. If I take 996 available sutras of Jaimini and begin to write a commentary at the rate of 20 pages per this sutra with example, how much will be it be?
19,000 pages.
Right? So I say it will be terrible. It can never be done. But that is the Indian tradition. They give you one simple four-line sutra and when you begin to unravel, it seems to be unending to you. Okay. That is the first three. So please remember, when you read books translated and made available to you, you have to go very slowly. You have to apply your mind. So now I come to the second part. Application of the mind has three stages. First is known as Adhyayan. Adhyayan means just reading. You have read a book, okay? Any translation you have read. Adhyayan. If you stop there, you never learn the subject. After Adhyayan comes Manan. Manan is, in modern terms, repeated application of the principle to hundreds of horoscopes to find out the real meaning. That is the replication or repetition or statistical proof of a meaning. Right? Statistical researches which we have been producing in India take us to the second stage of manan. Repeatedly you say, this is coming into my experience like this, it means this, it means this, it means this. Then come to the third stage, nididhyasan. Nididhyasan is that stage of yoga reached in astrology, when through yogic concentration, you begin to suddenly get an insightful meaning. You develop an insight like a yogi, unfoldment of hidden secrets. Well, it doesn't mean only this, it can mean so much. You gave me the horoscope of a famous... Who? Okay. Now you have not told me, but I am just asking you a question. I am telling you something which is not given in any book. Find out whether he is the eldest or the youngest of the male children of his parents.
I don't know.
Yes, you find out and come tomorrow. Homework for you. He cannot be in the middle. Now this is not given in any book. This I discovered in my own way, in certain way. The moment you drew the horoscope, I said he has to be the youngest or the eldest. You never told me.
No.
So that is the nididhyasan stage. When you begin to do astrology, slowly you begin to means. That is the unfoldment. Here it is beyond the book now. Here your own sadhana, your own spiritual practice, your own astrological practice gives you this stage. It is like a discovery, right? This is unending in astrology, because astrology is the most difficult subject in the world and all unqualified people do it most easily, right? But if you do astrology with a disciplined mind, you will reach the stage of nididhyasan. In that sense, it becomes a meditation for you. Meditation. Now, I will ask you a question. You have a son? Yourself?
Yes.
And I am asking you?
No.
You don't have. A daughter?
No children.
No children.
No children.
Why?
Okay. Stopped a lot of people.
Pardon? Do you have Saturn in the 8th house?
Yes, I do.
Correct. Now it is just an observation. From there I begin to see a little closely now. What is this? Why this happened? Like that I go on. Okay. Now coming back to this. Having done this, now go to the third point, and here if you commit a mistake, astrology will be self-destructive for you. There is no astrologer who does not see his own horoscope, which is a wrong thing. In the old Indian tradition, if a father decided to teach astrology to a son, the first thing he did was never to tell him what his horoscope was and never even to tell him what were his birth details. I know many astrologers in India who come to me who do not know their own horoscopes. What will happen is you begin to grow subjective. And when you grow subjective, the first thing you do is create many ghosts for yourself, goblins, right? And here, 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 everywhere you have, haunting you all the time. So it's a well-known thing in India, they don't do it. But please remember, the Brihat Parashar Hora Shastra starts with Avatar Kathan. Avatar Kathan means all the avatars, Rama, Krishna, Buddha, Narasimha, Vamana, all when they incarnate in this world with only 1/3 of their divinity, 2/3 they keep in reserve, 1/3 only they take it and incarnate, they always incarnate under the patronage of one of the planets. That is why Lord Rama is referred to as Suryavanshi. Lord Krishna is referred as Chandravanshi, moon, sun, moon, Mars. They are all born under, in the lineage of one of the planets. What is the role of an avatara? The role of an incarnation is paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam. When God incarnates himself in the world, he protects the virtuous and destroys the evil persons. God creates, God preserves, God destroys. God will always have three roles: as a creator, as a protector, as a destroyer. When he is the creator, he is Brahma. When he is the protector, he is Vishnu. When he is the destroyer, he is Shiva, Rudra. When he is a destroyer, he is Rudra. Every planet has to have all the three roles. Remember, every planet therefore is a creator. Every planet is a protector, and every planet is a destroyer. These three secret roles you have to look into straight away. Brihat Parashar Hora Shastra starts with this. Most of the people in interpreting horoscopes forget this brilliant hint given by Parashar right at the start. So they say Rahu, oh bad. Shani, bad.
Yes. Do I remember right that Rahu is one of the four planets that has an incarnation that's not
Jesus? Varaha. Varaha.
Yeah, and isn't that one of the four?
Bor, B-O-A-R, Bor.
No, four, 1, 2, 3, 4, that is totally pure, and the others have some Jivatma sun or some Jivatma in it.
Rahu.
Is that right, Rahu?
No. Parashara refers to the nakshatras, the constellations or lunar mansions of Sun, Moon, Mars and Rahu as Paramatmansha planets. That is totally different. But Rahu is so important even there. You see that? Yes, amazing.
Because
it's a rakshasa. Yes. It is too hot, is it? It is too hot.
No.
Uh-huh.
Is it okay, everybody?
Is it very hot or is it okay?
Hot,
not
too cold.
Or? Huh?
It's fine.
It's okay? It's okay. So therefore, please remember, there is every planet is performing all the three roles simultaneously. Creating, preserving, destroying. What is it creating? When? What is it preserving? When? What is it destroying? When? That is very important. Right? Now, having understood that, we will go back to the stotra I had made you do when we do the stotras have which I had done for Graha Shanti. I'll read out the one about Rahu here. Ardhakayam Mahavīryam Chandraditya Vimardhanam सिंहिकगर्भसंभूतं तं राहुं प्रणमाम्यहम्. In all the stotras, they describe and also give you secret hints for their predictions, how you should make use of them. In Sanskrit language, they give lots of synonyms. In a typical book I will get in India on Rahu, the synonyms of Rahu will be 10 or 15. If you concentrate on those synonyms, you will get 10-15 different applications of Rahu for predictions. Right? Ardhakayam Mahaviryam. Ardhakayam means half-bodied. Mahaviryam means very heroic. Chandra Ditya Vimardhanam. The person who gives trouble. Son. Right? Simhika Garbha Sambhutam. Born of Simhika. Mother's, Rahu's mother's name is Simhika. Tam Rahum Pranamamiham. I make my obeisance to that Rahu. That is the meaning. Ardhakayam Mahaviryam. Now Mahaviryam means what? Very heroic. So one of the qualities of Rahu is heroism. Right? Heroism. Now that heroism can be very destructive. It can be very constructive. The quality of heroism Rahu in your horoscope shows is what you have to analyze. But Rahu makes you a hero. In the 10th. So, he is a hero. The Mahaviryam, Chandra Aditya Vimardhanam. Sun and moon, he troubles the sun and the moon. Okay, now continue. Raudram Raudratmakam Ghoram. Isn't it there or not? In for Ketu. For Ketu, you see. Palash Pushpa Sankasham Taraka Graha Mastakam Raudram Raudratmakam Ghoram. That is the ferocious side of Ketu also is described. So these stotras are not simple stotras of worship only. In that worship they also describe the type of results you can expect from them. Now, the Hindu scriptures are full of references to many of these planets, and the stories relating to those planets give you very valuable hints about how to make use of them for predictions. I will digress a little and tell you. In your own cases, please analyze, and in the cases of children in your house, are in your family, find out when they are passing through the dasha of the moon and Mercury or Mercury and moon.
What about a baby that's born into moon Mercury?
That is not this thing, but I am finding out the teenage. In the teenage period, when the person is passing through moon Mercury or Mercury moon, that can be a highly creative period. That can be a period for drug addiction also. That can pardon?
Just for you, I'm going to the moon Mercury.
Will you describe your horoscope?
Mine. Chandra in the third house.
Start with the lagna.
And Chandra is in.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And Rahu in Aries.
Okay.
And
which is the year of Which is the year of your birth?
1948.
What month?
November. I can tell you.
Huh, tell me.
Saturday.
If you feel shy, then my coming to America is useless. If you feel shy, then I should not come to USA.
Oh, that's okay.
Don't feel shy.
Venus in Virgo.
What is the date you said?
Shukra in Virgo.
No, what is the date of your birth? November.
November
13. November? 1948. November 30. 1313, okay. Saturn in Leo. Jupiter in Sagittarius, Mars in Scorpio, Sun in Libra, Venus in Virgo, Mercury in Libra, Rahu in Aries, Ketu in Libra, and the Moon is Pisces. Right? Pisces. Are you doing full-time astrology now?
I study every day a little.
Pardon?
I study every day a little.
Okay. Are you married? You're not. What is happening in your job now? Nothing. No developments. Right?
No what?
No developments. In your job, on your job front, right? Any difference of opinion? Are you doing any work?
I'm busy every day, all day.
Doing what?
Whatever I want.
What is your source of earning? Pardon?
I have none.
Then how do you live? You have an inheritance. Then how do you live? You're like a yogi. Like a yogi. Very good. But you are passing through a favorable period as far as astrology is concerned. Right? You are doing your astrology well. Okay? Okay, we could discuss other things. But you are 48 born, so you are not a teenager. Unless you insist that you are.
No.
In the case of a teenager, when you see Moon Mercury or Mercury Moon period, see that extra softness that comes into their life. Because both are soft planets. Right? One major, one minor. Okay? Artistry comes into play. Very good. In the case of a teenager, when that artistry comes into play, he may begin to neglect studies and become a fan of Michael Jackson. Right? Or he may fall into a wrong company and may begin to take to drugs. Why does this happen? If you go to the original story of the birth of Mercury, there you get a hint. How was Mercury born? Mercury, Moon is a very handsome person, male. He enticed the wife of Jupiter. And Jupiter's wife became pregnant. Lord Brahma brought the wife back. Jupiter's wife gave birth to a Mercury. Therefore, what is the result? Result is Mercury has a grudge both against Jupiter and Moon. Because that illegitimacy which is attached to Mercury is because of the Jupiter and Moon. If you remember this story, you see why Mercury is the enemy both of Moon and Jupiter. Right? Jupiter is also the enemy of Mercury. But Moon is not the enemy of Mercury. Because Moon is the father, the biological father. Right? Jupiter is unhappy because Moon is not his child, but his wife gave birth. From here you get a hint. While Jupiter and Mercury will give their benefic results, all right, their mutual hostility is also to be taken into consideration in giving a prediction. Moon and Mercury are the fastest of the planets. All fast planets are fickle. Unless they get the stabilizing company of a good planet, they can ruin a horoscope. So in the Mercury-Moon period and Moon-Mercury period, you have to watch carefully what is happening to your psychology. In the case of a child or a teenager who are passing through a very delicate stage, they can fall into bad company, right? Therefore, invariably I always see this. When a teenager is passing through the period of Moon and Mercury, I tell them to watch out, be careful. Your Jupiter is in the 11th house, 10th house, 12th house, 12th from Pisces. What is the ascendant? Ascendant is Capricorn. So 12th in the 11th
in Sagittarius.
12th house, right? Now Jupiter is in Sagittarius, Mercury is in the 10th house. From Mercury, Jupiter is in the 3rd house. Now this disposition should also be seen. Okay, we'll come to that later. Now here you see, when you see these three roles, in seeing these three roles, the stories you have read in the Purana sometimes give you tremendous hint. I have made use of all the stories there in all my researches. Therefore, I asked Shivraj Sharma first to give the basic information you must have about Rahu. So in one simple, I'm asking to make it very brief, what one must know about Rahu. I'll read out. Page 4. Page 4. As a malefic, the deity represented by Rahu is Adi Shesha, the great serpent, on which earth rests, the great gravitational energy. Now please try to understand, all the predictive hints are starting from here. Adi Shesha, snake, right? According to Parashara, according to a recent astrological book known as the Lal Kitab, Rahu represents Bhairava, the destructive subordinate of Lord Shiva. Certain facts one must know about Rahu for good and successful predictions are: 1. He is the incarnation of Lord Varaha. For the propitiation of Rahu, worship of Varaha avatar is prescribed. Jayadeva's Dashavatar Stotra is the worship of all avatars for full propitiation of all planets. He represents the southwest direction. Right? always in retrograde motion, sometimes is also direct. Rahu stays in one Rashi for 1.5 years and has a daily motion of about 3 minutes. In the planetary cabinet, Rahu is given the portfolio of the army. Rahu represents leprosy and skin diseases. Rahu represents mlecha or an outcast. Rahu lives in snake holes. Rahu has a good height and a long body. You see people with Rahu in the Lagna, they'll not be short. Rahu represents metals. Rahu's color is black or blue, but always a smokiness in it. Rahu's habit is to utter falsehood and degrade others. Among cereals, Rahu represents urad or lintel. Rahu represents suicidal tendencies or cases of hanging. Among plants, Rahu is the bush. Among precious stones, Rahu is Gomez. Rahu causes windy complaints in the body. Rahu is material gain. Rahu is tamas guna. You know, sattva guna is light, rajo guna is activity, tamas guna is darkness. Rahu gives effects of evil spirits. I'll stop at 19 first and tell you, explain certain things to you. Once in a while, you do come across instances of people haunted by spirits. Have you or have you not?
Yes.
There you see the role of Rahu. I came across a very extraordinary instance about 14 years ago. Some person who had heard about me came to my house in Delhi and showed the horoscope of a girl. I was looking at the horoscope, I said, she should be a very brilliant student. He said, yes. Should be studying some classical subject, she said, Sanskrit. But I said, at the moment she seems to be suffering from some aberrations. He said, that is what I have come to ask you. Ghosts appear before her. Then I asked him to do Gita, 12th chapter. I said, she is a Sanskrit scholar, let her do it. The ghost vanished. Never came. I went on working on it. I came out with many original researches, which I will be presenting tomorrow and day after through this book. In Delhi, when you produce these researches, we get them tested first in the classroom. The books we are producing are classroom tested researches, remember that, which is not happening anywhere else in the world, even in India. We have 500 students. We present it, test it, see the exceptions, then write the books. So Rahu represents poison. Rahu represents mental aberration. Rahu represents ghosts. Therefore, in USA, when you talk of chronic fatigue syndrome, right? You have heard about it, all of you? You see the role of Rahu there. Role of the 6th and the 8th rod apart, role of Rahu. Or when you talk of mental aberrations, psychosis, neurosis, see the role of Rahu. Phobias, see the role of Rahu. Then how can the Rahu be controlled? That's all. So Rahu is very material in a psychological analysis of a horoscope. A person who has missed the role of Rahu in a horoscope is missing a basic principle.
Pardon? 6th and 8th floors, what did you say about that?
Pardon? Pardon?
Oh, the chronic fatigue syndrome is associated with 6 and 8 calories, as well as rotten.
Yes, those things.
Okay.
I'll come to many instances here in the book. Now, Rahu's exaltation, debilitation, there has been a difference of opinion. First, briefly in the book, it is being introduced. Rahu is exalted in Taurus according to Parashara, in Gemini according to others. Rahu owns Kumbha according to Parashara, but Virgo according to others. The Mool Trikona Rashi of Rahu is Gemini according to Parashara and Aquarius according to others. The debilitation sign of Rahu is Scorpio according to Parashara, Sagittarius according to others. The lords of which nakshatras? Rahu rules 3 nakshatras, Ardra, Swati and Satibhisha. The friends of Rahu are Mercury, Venus and Saturn. Aspects. There has always been a controversy about the aspects of Rahu. Many writers feel that since it is a shadowy planet, it cannot have any aspect. But many others use the aspects of Rahu for the predictions. Different writers give different aspects thus. Some people say 5, 7, 9, 12 according to some, right? 5th and 7th according to others. Others take only the 5th, 7th and the 12th. When Rahu is troubling, propitiation or shanti of Rahu is done to ward off the evil effects of Rahu. Worship of Goddess Durga. Someone recommends worship of Lord Shiva or Bhairava, and fasting on Saturday. This is what is prescribed.
When you look at the aspects,
pardon?
Rahu, you...
I don't take aspects.
You don't.
Personally, left to myself, I don't take any aspect of Rahu. Right? Now, having said that, as I told you, I am making use of both books. Right? Now, I am going to astrology and karma. Here, I am giving you the instances. From, is it from astrology and karma? You noted down. This one.